The scriptures tell us that in the book of Exodus, 600,000 men left with Moses the bondage of Egypt, headed to the promised land. So we know that there were at least 2 million people in that crowd, including women and children. They saw the mighty works of God in Egypt. They saw the plague of locusts and frogs. They saw the darkness. They saw the hail, the lightning, and the thunder. They went through the Passover, the Pesach of God, the wing of God covering them in protection from the angel of death that passed over. They saw the Egyptians terrified of them. Imagine slave owners being terrified of their slaves, just handing out gold and silver, clothing, precious stones, all kinds of precious things they gave to the people of Israel. And then they went out strong, in order, families, tribes. They made their way out toward the Red Sea. Now, they're going into familiar territory for Moses. Across the Red Sea is the place where he would shepherd his sheep, moving them constantly because there would be very little growing that they could eat. But he had been to the mount a number of times. It was there that he saw the burning bush. Now, they come out of this Red Sea, and the scriptures tell us that it was their baptism that they died. Well, they did. Their identity as slaves ended when the Egyptians were destroyed. They knew there was now no longer a possibility of any recapture. They were not going to be slaves. They had escaped from Egypt, and they were on their way to the promised land. The difficulty, a great difficulty, is that they were taken the long way and not the short way. They could have easily made it to the promised land in 10 days. But that would have meant going through the Philistine territory, and God said he would not take them that way because even though they were armed for battle, they were not ready for battle. They still had a slave mentality. And so as the children of Israel come out into that wilderness, the Red Sea closes behind them. Now, I'm sure Moses thought about this, but I think the people were so caught in the excitement of leaving and in the excitement of escaping from the Egyptians that it did not dawn on them that they were now in the desert, in the wilderness, and there was no way they could make it safely out of that wilderness before they would die. They had left behind civilization. They were in a place where there was not enough food to even begin to meet their needs. There was not enough water to take care of their livestock. Any person who would have just sat down and thought logically for a moment would have recognized that they were literally in a wilderness where there was every probability that without God's direct intervention, they would die. They were in a place where they could not rescue themselves. Now, I don't know about you, but I always like to have a fallback plan. Okay, I'm willing to move forward, but if that doesn't work, can I get to safety? Well, they could not cross the Red Sea again. God was not going to open that Red Sea for them. They were trapped in that wilderness, and there was no plan B. Pharaoh had said, "You either serve me or you die." Moses said, "No, there's a third option. We can serve God." But now it looks as though serving God means we die. So we pick up the story in the 16th chapter of the book of Exodus. This is the story of Moses, the pilgrimage of Moses. This broadcast is called Pilgrim's Progress. It was named after that awesome allegory written by John Bunyan, Pilgrim's Progress, as he tells the story of Christian who is burdened by sin, reading the book, conviction growing in his heart, and then finally meeting evangelist, crying out to evangelist, knowing that the city was going to be burned and not knowing how to escape, trying to convince his wife and his children to join him on the pilgrimage. They refuse. They scorn him. And so by himself, he heads out. And through many trials and temptations, many hard times, but always sustained by God, he finally makes it through, by faith, the Jordan River and enters the Cana land, the celestial city. That's what this broadcast is about. I'm not interested in teaching you some fine theology, even though you will learn fine theology by listening. My primary interest is not educational or inspirational. My primary concern on this broadcast is, what progress are you making toward the celestial city? Are you, in fact, making progress, or are you at a dead standstill? If you're at a dead standstill, you're coasting downhill, not uphill. So my concern is, what progress are you making in your journey toward heaven? If you're not making any progress, get started today in very practical ways. And that's what we're going to talk about today out of Exodus, the 16th chapter. If you'd like to join and be a part of this broadcast, you're welcome to. It's 877-534-0780. That number again is 877-534-0780. My name is Ray Greenlee. I pastor the National Prayer Chapel in Woodbridge, Virginia. You can find all the information at nationalprayerchapel.com. That's nationalprayerchapel.com. Now, you remember when we left the children of Israel, they had faced a very difficult situation. They were thirsty, and the only water was at Marah, and it was bitter. It was poison. They could not drink it. And they grumbled against God after having just been delivered at the Red Sea. Reality is now beginning to settle in on their heart that if they don't do something to extricate themselves, they will die. But they have no ability to extricate themselves. They have no ability to change their situation. This is exactly what the kingdom of God is about. You have no ability at all to save yourself. Your only hope is that you would repent and cry out to Jesus and ask that the cross of Jesus be cast into your circumstances, that you could be crucified, that you could repent and renounce your evil ways, and that Jesus in his mercy and his grace would give to you and would make you righteous by his love and shed blood on Calvary. So a piece of wood was cast into this water, and the water became sweet. They moved on from Marah deeper into the wilderness, and then they came to Elim. When God begins to bring you into the wilderness, a place where you have renounced the world, you've renounced all the pleasures of the world, You have determined in your heart that you want Jesus and Jesus alone. You will always come to Mara. You will come to a place of bitterness. And in that place of bitterness, God wants to test you, not tempt you. God does not tempt, but he wants to test you. He wants to test you and see if because of the great deliverance of the Red Sea, you will now place your faith and your trust in Jesus alone and stand that he will give you water in the desert. As I speak this word today, I just sense in the Spirit, I sense this early this morning as I was praying for you, that there are many of you who are at Mara. You have things happening in your life that are bitter to your heart. You have humiliation. You have lack and poverty. You have things in relationships that are just causing you to feel like turning angry and bitter. But the story is, cast the cross of Jesus into that thing and let your flesh be crucified and lift up hands of praise and worship to Jesus, and he will bring you quickly to Elim. And Elim is the place where there are 72 palm trees, or 70 palm trees and 12 springs. In other words, an abundance of shade and water for you in this very difficult time. But unfortunately, they don't stay very long at Elim. Instead, they move on quickly, deeper into the wilderness. They come in chapter 16 to the part of the desert that is called the desert of sin. Now, that's not accidental. There are no accidents in the scripture. The desert of sin. They come to this 2.5 months after leaving Egypt. 2.5 months, they have no food stores remaining. They've eaten all their bread. They've eaten all the food they brought with them. They don't have any food left. And they're hungry. And so what are they going to do? Are they going to cry out in anger against God again? Or are they going to do what one dear sister wrote to me this morning? Let me see if I can get it for you quickly. She and her husband are in a very, very difficult place. This is what she wrote this morning at 8:43 a.m. Jesus has the victory. Now you understand. This family is at a total dead standstill. They don't know how financially they're going to survive. Everything is shutting down on them. And then they just got word that they have to move. So financially, they are in a desperate, desperate situation. This is what she wrote. Jesus has the victory! Exclamation, exclamation, exclamation. Even if we can't see a single thing, he is here. I am asking him to quiet my soul and keep me still before him. I believe that the change is coming. But at the same time, I'm letting go of all expectation and just waiting with a smile. Jesus is so awesome. With three happy faces following that text message. Now that's a testimony. If the children of Israel, when faced with hunger, after being at Elim with its 70 spring or 12 springs and 70 palm trees, a place of comfort, suddenly their comfort is taken away. They're thrust deeper into the wilderness. Why? Because God wants them to grow in faith and trust. He wants them to forget about themselves and focus their attention on him. And so this dear one writes, Jesus has the victory. Even if we can't see a single thing, he is here. I'm asking him to quiet my soul and keep me still before him. I believe that the change is coming, but at the same time, I'm letting go of all expectation and just waiting with a smile. Jesus is so awesome. I read that text this morning with tears in my eyes. I know the price that dear woman is paying with her husband and her children. And no apparent way out. No deliverance on the horizon. Everything looks utterly hopeless. Everything is shut down. The business is crashed. The house they have to move out of because the owner is selling it. There's no money to move. There's no money to meet the expenses. What should they do? Exactly what this dear sister is doing. Ask Jesus to quiet your heart. Ask Jesus to turn his face to you. And you turn your face toward Jesus. And with a smile, say, Jesus is awesome. Even when I don't have anything, Jesus is awesome. But the children of Israel did not travel this way. The children of Israel grumbled again against Moses and Aaron. They said to them, if only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted. But you've brought us out of this into the desert, and we're going to starve. The entire assembly, we're going to starve to death. You can see why these people would later litter the desert with their bodies, because they refused to believe the word of the Lord God Almighty. They would only believe what they could see and feel. That is, they would only believe in the physical realm. They saw the magnificent miracles of God crashing down out of divine supernatural power. But they would only believe in the physical realm. They would not believe in the spirit realm. They were only concerned with how their bodies were going to survive. Can I say to you, please? It does not matter how your body survives. It matters if your spirit is one with Jesus, and if you are going to go through, no matter how difficult, no matter how painful, are you going to lift your hands up to Jesus and surrender in the midst of the desert? Or are you going to go back to the old ways, to the old wickedness? Please, this is so very, very hard. Because when things close down on us, there is a cry of self-preservation that rises out of the depths of every man and woman's heart. It is counterintuitive to not believe in the physical realm, but instead to believe in the spirit realm. All of us would quickly say, nothing is too hard for God to do. Great, will God do something? Well, I don't know. Will he? Do you trust him? Well, all of us can remember times in the past when we have trusted God and he hasn't chosen to do anything. So maybe I am left to myself, and maybe I do have to just take care of business and do what I'm supposed to do. Well, that's going to depend on whether you want your will or you want God's will. You see, in my life, when God did not do what I asked him to do, I had to come to terms with the fact that my will and God's will are often very different. And God is not here to satisfy my will. I'm here to fit in with God's will. God is not a Santa Claus. He's not a Coke machine. He's not a rabbit's foot that you rub for good luck. He is a person. He is real. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and he is the one who rules over heaven and earth. I don't rule over heaven and earth. I don't rule over money. I don't rule over people's lives. I don't rule over anything. It is God who rules over everything. So when God doesn't do what I want him to do, and then I begin to say, this is unfair, it's unjust, why is God treating me this way? Well, then we're saying God is our servant. The truth is, we're called to be his servants. I have been in a place where I've simply said, Lord, if you don't answer my prayer, I'll die. And that's okay. I trust you. But I'm going to die with a smile on my face and my hands lifted up to you. I cried out to the Lord to heal my wife. I was assured that she would be healed. And she died. Well, in my mind, to be healed means to be restored to me as my wife. But from God's perspective, to be healed meant to be taken home with Jesus. Well, frankly, I wasn't pleased at all with his decision. But I wasn't in charge. And so what I've had to do is lift my hands to him and smile and say, Jesus, thank you. You knew what was best. You did what was best for my wife, and you did what was best for me. I don't understand it, but I don't need to understand it. Nowhere in the scripture does it tell me I have to understand God's work. It tells me just the opposite. You're not going to understand what God is doing. It's okay. Trust him. I trust him. So I've been in a place where I have asked for God's will, and my precious one died. I said, Lord, why couldn't have you let her live and taken my life? And then I quickly said, but Lord, I'm sorry. I'm not in charge, and I'm not in a place to question you. I simply want to tell you I trust you. I trust you. Even if my wife dies, I trust you. And Jan said to me before she died, if I'm not healed, Ray, at my funeral, say, the Lord gives and the Lord takes. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And so I did that. I'm still doing it. This precious family that I've spoken of is in such a very painful and difficult financial place. I know what they're saying because I've sat and talked with them and prayed with them and stood with them. I know what they're saying. They're saying, Lord, even if we die, even if we perish, we will trust you. If we lose our house, we trust you. If we lose our car, we trust you. If we lose our business, we trust you. Lord, your will be done, not our will. Your will be done. Children of Israel would not do that. They stood with angry accusations against the Almighty. Please let me ask, Do you have any angry accusations against God? Has what has happened in your life displeased you? And you say it's not fair? You say life is not fair? God is not fair? Why have I been treated this way? So many men that I meet are angry men. They're angry because of the way they've been treated by a teacher, a professor, a friend, parents, brothers and sisters. They've just got a gut full of anger. I tell them, take time, take paper and pencil, write down the name of everyone who has harmed you, everyone who's hurt you, everyone who's treated you unjustly, including God, from your perspective. And then I said, please go through that list, one by one, person by person, and pray a prayer of forgiveness, and forgive them. Let it go. And the ones that are hard, ask the Lord to give you the gift of repentance in your heart and forgiveness. And then forgive God. Well, God never sins. But your accusations have said that he sins. So go ahead and forgive God too. And then take the next step and say, Lord, thy will, not my will. And turn your life over to him. You'll find the anger is gone. It may take some time, but the anger will leave your heart and your soul. Are you angry? Are you hurt? Are you bitter? Forgive them. Let it go. Come to a place in your heart where you refuse to do what the children of Israel did. Come to a place in your heart where you say, I will trust the Almighty. He is faithful and true. He is just. He is filled with love and compassion, with tenderness. I was just thinking through this morning as I was praying before coming, the great, incredible kindness that God has shown to me through the years. I've gotten myself into some very difficult places by sins that I have committed, by actions that I have taken, by things that I have said. I've gotten myself into some very real difficulty. And I look back today and I recognize how God came in his great mercy and he rescued me. I've been in some places where the Lord has directed me into a dead end, a trap, where suddenly I was losing everything and I had no ability to deliver myself. I could not create money out of thin air. God can, but I can't. Places of utter death, impossibilities, homeless, having lost houses and cars and retirement and savings, all following Jesus. What kindness God has shown me in opening the way for me. I remember coming to Woodbridge, Virginia at the command of God. And suddenly, no income, staying in a hotel room, spending all day praying, reading the scriptures, waiting on God. And then miraculously, meeting a pastor of a large mega church that normally you would never get close to him, let alone become friends. And having $10,000 in an envelope shoved across a desk to me. Ray, this is for you to open the church, the National Prayer Chapel. Use it however God tells you to use it. I have no accountability. You're accountable before God. He just told me to give it to you. And my wife and I looking at this $10,000 in cash and saying, Lord, how is it possible that a day ago we didn't have enough money to even pay the hotel room? We didn't have the money to repair the car. It looked impossible. And suddenly here I am, an envelope with $10,000 in it. And over the years, this dear pastor gave more than $150,000 to help open the National Prayer Chapel. Never once did I ask for a penny. Always it came unexpectedly at the command of Jesus to his heart, because he believed God was calling for a National Prayer Chapel in Woodbridge, Virginia. Only God can open the way. Do you need God to open the way for you today? If you do, I'd be happy to pray with you. I'd be happy to talk with you. Do you need God to open the way in victory over your sin? Are you in an impossible place where you're tired of your wickedness? You're tired of your sinful lifestyle? You're tired of playing games with God, and you'd like to come and have that broken through? You'd like to have healing in your heart? You'd like to be released from bondage? Then call right now. I'll pray with you. Phone number is 877-534-0780. My name is Ray Greenlee. I pastor the National Prayer Chapel in Woodbridge, Virginia. Let me give you some information while I wait, give you an opportunity to call. The National Prayer Chapel meets at the All Saints Anglican Church in Woodbridge, Virginia. Let me give you that address. We'd love to have you come and worship with us. If you know that you're ready to think about putting all of your trust in Jesus, and you're ready to go on this pilgrimage with him, you're ready to follow him, or you're ready at least to talk about following Jesus, maybe you have some questions, come to the National Prayer Chapel on Sunday. 12 noon, we begin with prayer. At 12:30, we begin with praise and worship. You're welcome to come. Bring the children, bring the family. We meet at All Saints Anglican Church. It's located at 14851 Gideon Drive. That's 14851 Gideon Drive, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22192. That zip again, 22192. Now we have people who are driving from all over the area, as far away as Frederick, Maryland, Germantown, Maryland, Prince William County, Prince George's County, Dumfries, and south. People come from all over. Why? Distance is no obstacle because their hearts are hungry for Jesus. Is your heart hungry for Jesus? Then come. Go to our webpage. You can get very explicit directions, it's nationalprayerchapel.com, nationalprayerchapel.com. And our mailing address is the National Prayer Chapel, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. Again, it's Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. I'd love to hear from you. Now, as the children of Israel stand empty, hungry, saying, "I wish we died in Egypt," their heart in utter rebellion against God, claiming that they sat around flesh pots, they had all they wanted to eat as slaves, and now blaming God and blaming Moses and saying, "You just brought us out here to kill us." And the Lord speaks. And by the way, I want to tell you, God is so gracious. At first, when we walk in unbelief, He will be extremely patient. But after a while, if we continue in that course, He will bring judgment upon us. I'll show you that as we progress in the story of Moses. The Lord now speaks to Moses, and He says, "I will rain down bread from heaven for you. The people are to go out each day and gather enough for that day. In this way, I will test them to see whether or not they will follow my instructions. On the sixth day, they are to prepare what they bring in, and that is to be twice as much as they gather on the other days." So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, "In the evening, you will know that it was the Lord who brought you out of Egypt. In the morning, you will see the glory of the Lord because He has heard your grumbling against Him. Who are we that you should grumble against us?" Moses also said, "You will know that it was the Lord when He gives you meat to eat in the evening and all the bread you want in the morning, because He's heard your grumbling against Him. Who are we? You are not grumbling against us, but against the Lord." Now the children of Israel went out the next morning, and there on the ground was something white. And they said, "What is it?" The word manna means, "What is it?" God called it bread from heaven. They called it, "What is it?" Let's talk about the manna for the few minutes we have remaining in today's broadcast. The manna was literally a supernatural gift. It was not the product of anything on this earth. It was not the product of something that they manufactured in the desert. It was not something that grew on trees. It was not something that they carried with them from Egypt. This was supernatural. It fell from the heaven. They could not cause it to fall. God caused it to fall. Now, we're going to want to carefully look at this question of manna, because the manna first fell in the desert of sin. In other words, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Jesus Christ is the manna. He fell from heaven. He was not created by man. He was born of a woman, fully God and fully man. But He was God. The second thing I want you to see about this manna is that it came right to where the people were. It didn't fall 10 miles out in the wilderness. It fell right where the people were. It was readily accessible to them. Jesus is readily acceptable or accessible to you today. Right now, Jesus is available to you. We often refer to the scriptures as manna. It is both the scriptures and it is Jesus himself who are the manna of the new covenant. It came right to where the people were. If they did not pick it up, they would trample it under their feet. And when the hot sun rose, it melted away and disappeared. The manna was small in size, meaning you could not go out and pick up a hunk of it. You cannot go into the scriptures and pick up a big hunk of it and eat it. You have to eat the scriptures in small bites, and you have to chew it. It's not pablum. It's not like the television or the entertainment. The scriptures require chewing, masticating. The manna is to be eaten. You first have to appropriate the food. In other words, you have to read it. You have to eat it. As you begin to read the word and you chew it with your spiritual teeth, you then have to assimilate it. Now, let me illustrate what I'm talking about. Let me turn quickly to Psalm 23, and you'll see what I'm talking about. So many people listen intellectually to the word, but they don't chew it. They don't meditate on it. Meditation, in the Buddhist sense, is you empty your mind. Meditation, in the Christian sense, is that you clear everything of this world away and you meditate on the Word of God. You meditate on Jesus Christ. You chew and masticate the Scriptures. That's the very best of meditation. Listen. The Lord is my shepherd. And I have to stop and begin to ask questions. Who is it that I trust to be my shepherd? Who do I trust to take me to where food is? Who do I trust to bring the resources into my family that I'll need? Is the Lord truly my shepherd? Do I follow him and he guides me away from poison plants to still waters? Does he bring to me the sustenance of my life? Does he guard me from the wolves? Does he guard me from the bear and the lion? Can you trust Jesus? Well, you see, if you'll begin to chew on that, there's quite a lot to chew in just that first phrase of the 23rd Psalm. And then it says, I shall not be in want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. Well, you know that if you're a farmer, that sheep will not lie down until they're absolutely comforted with food. And they will continue to pull up the grass until the whole pasture is barren if there's not enough food. So the 23rd Psalm is saying there will be so much food you can eat your fill, and then you're going to lie down in it, and it will be green. In other words, you can chew on this scripture and get all the nourishment your body wants or desires. Your spiritual body. Everything you desire in your inner person is satisfied by chewing on this word of God and meditating upon it. It says, he leads me beside quiet waters. Sheep are afraid of fast running water. They're afraid they'll fall in. They're afraid it'll sweep them away. So the shepherd has to dam up the water so that there's still water that the sheep can drink from. He restores my soul, or he returns my soul to a righteous place. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. You are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. In other words, I side with the Holy Spirit against my wolf nature. His rod encourages me. His staff rescues me. I was speaking with a brother yesterday, and he said to me, I'm always greatly encouraged by the Lord's rebuke. It means he's still here, and he still loves me, and he's still ordering my steps. If he weren't, I would get lost. I wouldn't know what way to turn. But he comes and rebukes me, and that's an encouragement. But you see, you need time to think about siding with Jesus against your wolf nature. Our wolf nature wants to rise up and accuse God and accuse others. Our wolf nature wants to arise and slash other people and gossip about them and speak poorly of them. Our wolf nature wants to rise up and grab everything for self. But Jesus says, side with me against your wolf nature. Don't give in to it. Cut it off. Repent of it. And as you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you're not going to fear any evil. In other words, when you walk and you don't have a house to live in, and you don't know where you're moving, and you don't know what's going to happen with your car, and you don't know what's going to happen with your job, you don't know what's going to happen with your support for your children and your wife, when everything looks absolutely hopeless, you're walking through the valley of the shadow of death. He says, fear no evil. Your rod, your staff, they comfort me. You're with me. Is this your actual experience? Is this how you walk? Do you see how you could chew on this very short, brief psalm for many hours? I do. It says, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Well, who are my enemies? My sin that I no longer walk in, that comes saying, come, walk in my sin. You'll enjoy it. Said Jesus, I stand by faith, I'm delivered. I'm not going to go there again. I cut it off in the name of Jesus. I declare the blood of Jesus against that. And he gives me the victory. And I don't walk in that sin anymore. He washes me and makes me whole. He applies the salve of his Holy Spirit to my wounds. He pours in the wine and the oil. Do you see? It says, you anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Remember Daniel? He put his feet under the Lord's table. He said, I'm not going to defile myself with the king's table. Daniel was not accustomed to eating anything but that which came from the hand of God. And now the king of Babylon said, you're going to have to eat food that comes from my table. Daniel said, no, I'm not. I'm not going to eat the food that comes from the king of Babylon's table. I am going to eat only the food that comes from the table of God. What an awesome declaration. And King David, who wrote Psalm 23, he understands. He went and put his feet under Bathsheba's table. And the judgments of God fell on him. He lost the child. He became a murderer. Don't go put your feet under some somebody else's table. Put your feet under the table of the Lord. Have you gone to the devil's table like King Saul? He went to the witch of Endor. He asked her questions, "Bring up Samuel for me." The word was horrific, condemning. He fell on his face. And the witch of Endor said, "Come, sit at my table. Put your feet under my table." And he was persuaded. He sat at the witch's table and dined on the delicacies of the devil and left and committed suicide. I tell you, my brother, my sister, sit only at the table of the Lord. Sit only at the table of the Lord. Put your feet under the table of righteousness, of holiness. Don't put your feet under the table of the professional sports or of the movies. Don't put your feet under the table of bitterness and anger. Put your feet under the table of the Lord. And the promises are sure. He will prepare that table for you in the presence of your sins that you have committed, your enemies. He will anoint your head with oil. Your cup is going to overflow. He's going to make it so full, it'll overflow. This is the promise of God. This is what I mean when I say you're going to have to chew the manna of God. You're going to have to meditate on it. You're going to have to let it speak to your soul. Will you do that? Let me pray for you. Almighty God, you see the heart of each person. You see where they have their feet today. You see the table they're sitting at, ready to dine. Some, Lord, are listening to this broadcast and they're ready to dine with the devil. I ask that you would cause them to get up quickly from that table and run to the table of God, that they might put their feet under your table, that you might prepare the table for them in the presence of their enemies, that you might make a way where there is no way. Lord, would you do that now? In the name of Jesus. Amen. I'm Ray Greenlee. I pastor the National Prayer Chapel in Woodbridge, Virginia. Go to nationalprayerchapel.com. Come and visit us this coming Sunday. God bless you. I'll talk to you soon. His glory with great joy, with great joy. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory.